Good afternoon to one and all present in this virtual platform. I, Jyotiranjan Mahanti, on behalf of the ATL Club of DAV Public School Chandrasekharpur, welcome you all to today's gala afternoon. Esteemed RO Company, Dr. Keshav Chandra Satpathy, Revered ARO Madam Dr. Sujata, admired principals of the sister concerned schools, respected afternoon, coordinator of the school, Madam Indira Bhattacharya, all the supervisors, my fellow colleagues, parents, and my loving children. We all gather here in this online forum to celebrate the fourth foundation day of Atal Tinkering Lab of our school. In 2017, our school got an opportunity to run innovation up in the form of ATL. Since then, our children are not made to settle for anything less than that what ignites their spirit. People outside the ATL think the students here write only codes, but in reality, they all were not writing codes. Rather, they were rewriting the future. In this pandemic time, it's difficult to take you all on a tour to our lab, but thanks to the advancement in technology, which enables us for a virtual tour of our lab, along with its achievements since 2017. So without wasting much of the time, let's watch this video.
Create scientific temple and cultivate a spirit of curiosity and innovation among young minds is something that is very necessary for the development of our nation. The Government of India has set up the Atal Innovation Mission at Niti Aayog, realizing the need of cultivating 1 million children in India as neoteric innovators. Presenting the Atal Tinkering Lab, another wonder of Devi Public School Chandrasekharpur, Bhubaneswar, Odisha. We are what we are because of the guidance of our esteemed principal sir, Dr. Keshav Chandra Satpathy, our patron, our coordinator ma'am, Madam Indira Bhattacharya, and our honorable mentors. A heartfelt token of gratitude to each and every one of them. The door of Atal Tinkering Lab, the door to think and tinker, the door that unfolds the ways for innovation, builds up creativity, critical thinking, cognitive thinking, innovation, and experience. The ATL of our institution can house about 60 students and has a projector set up, a whiteboard, has two soldering stations, and much more. Let's have a look at our beautiful ATL lab. A lab to innovate, a lab to design, and of course, a lab to learn more and more. One of the most important gadgets of our ATL lab, a printer that can easily print three-dimensional object. The Atal Tinkering Lab of DAV Chandrasekharpur was inaugurated by Sri Shubrata Bagchi on 4th September 2017. Sri Shubrata Bagchi, Chairman Skill Development Authority of the Government of Odisha, with other dignitaries, inaugurating the Atal Tinkering Lab on 4th September 2017. Sri Shubrata Bagchi interacting with the students of DAV CSPUR. Sri Shubrata Bagchi, Chairman Skill Development Authority of Government of Odisha, lighting the lamp during the inauguration. Regional Officer, DAV Odisha Zone 1, Dr. Keshav Chandra Satpathy, lighting the lamp. The Chairman Skill Development Authority of the Government of Odisha, Sri Shubrata Bagchi, addressing the gathering. One of our most memorable moments, let's have a look at the first national workshop that was held at Gujarat, especially for mentors. Our first innovative 4-day workshop held at the session 2017-18. There can be no real achievement without any struggle. Let's contemplate upon the achievements of our students and teachers over the year 2017 and 18. Nihar Modi, Amit Vaishnav, Gyanit Sahu, Krishita Pritam, Pallavi Priyadarshini and Arpita Mohanty were selected for the top 30 of the Atal Innovation Mission in the first phase since the setting up of ATL in this institution. 105th Indian Science Congress, which was held first in Osmania University, Hyderabad, and then in Manipur University, ended with the crowning of Prishita Pritham as the national champion. She was felicitated by the Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi. Here we have the runners-up in the RoboWars event conducted by IIT Bhubaneswar 2018-19. The team was accompanied by our ATL mentor and comprises of Nihar Modi, Siddhant Patnaik, Prithiraj Nayak, Rishikesh Amit Nayak and Shruti Parnagatha. The event was called Visionair 2018. It showcased matches between teams from colleges from West Bengal, schools from Jharkhand, Bhubaneswar and colleges like ITER, Silicon, etc. Shruti Parnagatha receiving the Ignite Award of 2017. Let's have a look at the celebration of the second Foundation Day of Atal Tinkering Lab. The respected dignitaries in our school. Here we come across the workshops held in the session 2018-19. Students in a large number participated in the workshop. A little progress each day adds up to big results. Here we have our achievements in the session 2018-19. Gyanak Kumar of Class 12 bagged the third position with a cash prize of Rs. 30,000 in the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research CSIR Innovation Award for School Children in the year 2018, receiving award from the Director of Niti Aayog. Rahul Biswal of Class 12 received the Ignite Award of 2018 with an idea of visually challenged friendly navigation facilitation system. The SAI TED of 2018. Amritanshu Rath and Tanmaya Mohapatra of Class 8 bagged the first position in Sahodaya School Complex Science Exhibition of 2018, held at Keith International School, Bhubaneswar. The World Robot Olympiad in India 2018 was a national championship organized by India STEM Foundation at Ahmedabad, Gujarat during 15 to 16 September 2018. The project was Farm Obot and the theme was Food Matters. Sai Suman Rebirtha and Tanvi Malik of Class 7 bagged the second position in this Olympiad. Here we have the Inter-School STEM Exhibition organized by Mother's Public School, Bhubaneswar on 1st September 2018. Amritanshu Rath of Standard 8 bagged the first position in the junior category with his project related to Four Eyes. Swayam Shubham Giri of Standard 11 bagged the People Choice Award in the senior category with his project of D-Rail. Our school got the first prize in BMC Science, Mathematics and Environment Exhibition 2018 and was selected for district level. The project name was E-Swachh Bin by Swapnadeep Mohapatra of Class 9. It was held on 28 November 2018. Our project was selected for the National Children's Science Congress. The name of our project was E-Swachh Bin by Swapnadeep Mohapatra of Class 9 on 13 December 2018. ATL Marathon of Top 200 Projects. The felicitation of the winners of the National Science Exhibition held in the session 2018-19. ATL Marathon Top 100 Projects. Let's have a look at the Ideate for India organized by Intel Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. From top 10 ideas of Odisha, our school had 5 ideas in the list and they participated in the regional boot camp. Our participation in the 107th National Science Congress held in Bangalore from 2nd to 6th January 2020. The project name was E-Swachh Bin by Swapnadeep Mohapatra and Abhinav Mohanty. Our students never lagged behind in interacting with the visitors. Our overall champions of Avishkar Makeathon of 2019-20. The national champions were allowed to have a sponsored trip to London. Their achievement opened the gates to represent the state in the national level Children's Science Congress. In the year 2019, our school received a token of appreciation from Intel and Niti Aayog for the maximum contribution towards student innovation in the Eastern Zone.
Now here, our gems, selected in top 300 winners from all over the country and top 10 innovations from Odisha. Atal Tinkering Marathon 2020, organized by Atal Innovation Mission of Niti Aayog. Here we have Supreet Samal, Rishikesh Amit Naik and Kritika Panda. This year, in Inspire Manak 2021, our budding talent Abhishek Pahi of Class 10 has been selected for final round with the topic Car FE 2.0.
Our dedication, insight, innovation and enthusiasm has brought us this long. With the guidance and blessings of our mentors, we will have many more laurels to come in the coming years and a lot more reasons to celebrate. Thank you.
Indeed, this video must have made our intention and intent clear about the future of our ATL. From time insane, we were doing most of our projects using thermocol. But then came an era where we used sensors and coding to make our projects. Now it's the age of artificial intelligence. Let us take the privilege to invite the first speaker of this afternoon, Mr. Dhruv, founder Tinkering India Foundation. He is working as a trainer for a very long term across India, training young minds to innovate and eventually to solve community problems. He would demonstrate us about the transition from sensors to artificial intelligence. Over to you, Dhruv sir.
Thank you so much. Yes.
Okay.
Am I audible now?
Your voice is a bit low. So.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay. So thank you so much for giving me opportunity to reach up to this many of students and share knowledge, whatever I have. I'm just sharing my PPT. So all of you will be getting a view on it. Okay, is my PPT visible as a slideshow?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so like as all of you are already known to that world is changing so much fast. You have seen lot of version of mobile phones from everything going digital. Rise a question in our mind, what will be the future and how that future will be modified in the next generation, because everything has been going very fast. We need to predict what we will be doing. So I have tried my best to just get insight from history towards the future, covering all the basic aspect, and now let's go forward. So at very basic, like what we start as cycle of innovation. Let's understand the first of innovation, which we understand as a wheel was made from a stone. So now that wheel had some issues, that wheel had some problems. So now how that innovation was been modified. So the next innovation which came was the problem of weight was been solved by replacing as wood. And still, the surface still need to be very tough. So it was being covered by an iron rim. Still, there was certain problem in this wood base wheel. So that need to be addressed. So now the next wheel, which was been invented or designed, was something like that, where they significantly reduced the amount of wood, as well as they modified the design. So they added the structural component like spoke, and they added the axis, so that was much smoother and much easier to make it, as well as this need of the wood was significantly reduced due to the new design. But the same wheel still has certain problem for some extra usage like speed, like having a weight carrying capacity, all of those. So then the next level of wheel was designed. So this wheel you can compare with the current wheel, which we are using in motorbikes. It is very similar, but if you see, every era had, every design had a new innovation getting added into it. In this, we can see there is an innovation added as rubber. So now there is a suspension available. It is more durable, but still the same wheel cannot, complete a lot of other tasks, which is needed by us right now, like today. So then we need the high capacity wheels, which can take a lot of load, lot of weight. So then this kind of wheel was been designed. And nowadays you can see the wheel are coming as a tubeless tires. So we can easily, if there is a puncture, we can easily make it very well, and we can reuse it very well. So if you see our ideas, our each and every ideas start like a stone wheel, and slowly it goes refined by layer, as soon as we get aware of it, as we get some more information about innovation, we start putting those innovation and those learning into it, and we develop some smarter product as time goes. So this is the kind of cycle of innovation which you need to understand. The similar thing has happened. You can see there is a Morse code machine, which was been using in like 1950s during war to send messages. Then the new step came as text messages, where you can use a pager, where you can put some text message and it will be forwarded. Then voice call. Now see, slowly that has been came up to a smartphone. So the hardware is capable enough to do a lot of mathematical things, as well as it is having a lot of color option as a screen on display. So you can interact it very well. Now there is a touch point, so interaction capacity is also increased. So this is how the camera is also included. So it can do some lot of functions which can help us in the computer vision and all of those things right now. So advancement in technology, or advancement you can see in the wheel, is much similar. It is very slow wise, but it happens. Now all of you have gathered here and you all have an objective. What would be the objective? Why you are here? So today what we are planning is, we should focus on self-learning and awareness. So my entire session would be more focused on how you can learn, as well as what level of awareness is required if you are going further for doing some design or innovation or some technological advancement, or you are interested in it. So this is our basic objective for the session. So if you consider, so I have taken this particular topics like 21st century attitudes. So nowadays you can see lot of things machines can do, but something kind which machines cannot do is this. So if you start developing certain kind of attitudes, which will be the one of the most important attitudes in 21st century. So these are those, you can read it, I will send it again. But the most important of those are, first is leadership, because machines cannot lead. You will be the one who can take some leadership, take some initiative and solve some problems. Second is ability to work in team, because current technologies and current advancement required some specific specialized people who can be part of your team, and you all together can solve some problem. The others is problem solving skills, strong work ethic, computer skills and strategic plans. So these are some of the important, rest all are mostly covered in your academics. But the other parts which has been not covered into your academics journey, or by the time you graduate, the others need to be fulfilled. And I will definitely say Atal Tinkering Labs are doing great job in fulfilling those kind of skill sets as an attitude. So coming to the point, and then we have other slides, but the direct question for many of us is, rate of automation increased in industry is really point where we are thinking, do we will get the job, or machine will do our job? So if you see the percentage in 2020, currently 67% of the task we are doing, and 33% of the task in industry machines are doing. But sooner it will still go down. So by next 5 year, the rate will be increased in machines. So a lot of more advancement will come and the number of jobs in human sector will be decreased and more machines will come onto the role. So what will be the need now? So the need will be reskilling ourselves. And it has been predicted by World Economic Forum that reskilling is required by 2025 for 50% of all the employees. So whoever is working currently, you will be coming into job in 2025. But I'm talking about the people who are already working need reskilling. So think about how much upgradation you will also require. And similar way, now due to online availability of technology, like lot of courses are available and everything, the easiness of adapting the technology is also there. So if you want to learn something new, you can easily dedicate yourself for certain time and you can learn a lot of new technology or you're interested wherever your interest is. Because now you can see one of the most important area is cloud computing, analytics and all. And now that particular area is been expanding to each and every field, whether it is medical, whether it is in engineering, automobile, in any of your field you go, this kind of technologies are being implemented. So building new skills online is much easier and you need to just put certain time and you can easily learn that. Now, directly coming like job landscape. So what will be the job landscape in 2025? There will be a lot of new jobs will be coming into the market and there will be a lot of jobs which will decrease. So you have to restructure yourself in selection as well as when you are learning your academics, you have to make sure it has been interconnected. Your creativity has been happening onto that direction. So that will be really required. I have a list of skill sets. So these are the skills which will be most important. So you can see the problem solving skill set, self-management, work with people and technology use and development. So these are the type of skills which you will be most required. And rest all are other things which will be needed into upcoming industries. So if you see the top 10 among them, specifically for India, like this data has been taken from World Economic Forum. There is a report of Future Jobs 2020. So according to that, the demands of job growing in India are this 10. So where AI and machine learning specialists are really required. Now AI and machine learning is being applied at each and every domain right now, whether it is commercial, online shopping, if you go to accounting, if you go to medical, everywhere this machine learning and AI specialists are there. And they are doing a lot of data analysis and also first 5 jobs, if you see here, is all about cloud computing, AI and advancement in technology. Then definitely you have project managers, fintech engineers, digital marketing, software application and business development professionals. But they are getting added into each and every domain. Like you can see now Zomato was there. Recently, I just have seen an advertise of Astro Yogi. Now the person who come and say, okay, how much good is your future and all that to using digital technology. So this is how in each and every field, this particular things is getting in. So definitely if there is an increase somewhere or somehow there will be decrease in job demands. So certain job demands has been decreasing. You can see data entry clerks, bookkeeping, accounting, because all of those things are getting automated with the time as going on, because the computers can manage all those data very easily. It can structure it very well. It can give you the desired layout and formats, and you can print out and easily use it. So this is how lot of things like architecture and surveyors, because now with the drone technology and lot of digital technology, that survey can be done but much easier. So this is how the change will be coming into this domains where the jobs will be decreased because there the computers are replacing the job. So little bit tension, now what? So by knowing that these are the orientation towards future and the cloud computing and technology is increasing day by day, what we'll be doing? So our simple strategy should be for now as you all are student. So number one should be you should upgrade your approach. So how you are approaching towards any technology and what you are learning, how you are getting expertise on it, or how you are practicing would be much required. So you need to design that approach. So before designing an approach, let's do some awareness part. So how this particular thing happened and how this technology came, what are the base of those technology, and how we should focus on it. Coming to the point. So my title of the session was initially digital fabrication. Then sir said, sir, can you cover artificial intelligence also in it? I said, okay. So let's start from history to future. So in history, we can say that fabrication was been one of the most important part when innovation started coming to, into the chapters. What is fabrication? So we can easily say action or process for manufacturing or inventing something. 18th century and 19th century where first industrial revolution and second industrial revolution happened, where lot of new kind of manufacturing was there, lot of new invention happened. So first industrial revolution was in Europe and US, where what happened was new manufacturing processes for cloth making and everything started. That was in 1760s, 1820s, 1840. So a machine came, which was power loom. You all might be knowing also. So that it was weaving machine. So basically to weave particular cloth, they will be having a particular industry or an area where they will be having this kind of machine. You can see in the picture. Now, if you closely observe this picture, you can see something which I will be asking in the next slide, is lot of people working there. There are machines. It has been getting some energy from somewhere. So I'm asking one simple question, how those machine works? This machines need certain kind of movement, rotation, and that need to be transmitted. So they were getting energy from belt drive. So this particular belt will be connected through some pulleys, some drums where this has been there, and it will be rolling around. Now, while there is a belt, there is a problem. And what kind of problem will be there? So sometimes this belt, which is rolling around the drum, will slip off and come out. Now, if this kind of problem is happening, they need to stop every machine, and now they need to again set up the belt on it, and then they need to restart the process. So the problem was lot of people, time would be wasted, the process would be stopped for many of the machine, and now there was a solution required. So I'm repeating again, in this picture, it is 1835 where this kind of power looms was there. And there are belt drives which were around the drum. And if one belt drive comes off, it needs to stop all the machine, and we need to reorient the belt, and then we need to restart the machine. So there were certain problems which they were facing. Now, there was a need of certain solutions. This problem need to be solved. And it's called as the need to solve the problem and to solve need will be the basically necessity where innovation will happen. Now, there was a need, and the same time the second industrial revolution was about to begin. The second industrial revolution came and changed the entire industrial orientation. And what happened was in second industrial revolution, steel production started. Lot of machineries, use of steam power was started. Electrification just started beginning, where they started understanding electricity. Some basic communication like Morse code and telegraph and everything was widely started. Just modern organizational methods started happening. So this was just initialization of second industrial revolution. And in the beginning of second industrial revolution, Nikola Tesla invented electric motor. See, here it's really important point. Think about in 1888 when they designed the first motor, and it has been still used in lot of our equipments right now. So a single innovation in 1888 has changed a lot of industries by changing drive, basically how to power the energy. And the same time, the electricity was there. So now electric current was been creating the kinetic energy. So this mechanical energy can be utilized for a lot of work, and it can easily replace that steam engine because it is much better. It doesn't use water and it doesn't require a lot of space, and it can be individually fitted in each and every machine. So it can be easily, you know, operated, repaired, and if it is not working, it can be replaced also. So necessity is the mother of all invention, and we can easily identify, like, second industrial revolution created a lot of such thing which been ended in 1990s, like late 1900s. Second industrial revolution ended and the third industrial revolution started. So in this innovation or invention cycle, fabrication was the process to make all this innovation happen, where they join it, where they try something onto it. So fabrication is a process to make all this thing happen, the action or a process for manufacturing or invention. So this is how the fabrication has been defined. Now you can see the picture. In 1905, the first workable motor was being started using in industries. Then the speed controls came in. 1980s BLDC gear motors came in, and slowly now we have the high torque, high precise gear motors as well as stepper motors, which have been used in machines. So after that, third industrial revolution came into the chapter. Now I completed fabrication. Now we are going towards digital revolution. So in digital revolution, the rise of electronics has been so much, and that electronics came and started automating a lot of things around us. So those automation, what happened was with digital. So digital, you already know, it's all binary digits, either 0 or 1, which can help us to get more precision on its movement or lot of different things. And it also helps us in communication, widespread of the telecommunication system, which also helped in our economic development. So then what happened was, with the combination of that fabrication, where the motors are already there, and now we have the digital ecosystem, which can give us the all precise movement with the help of its position. So CNC, computer numerical control machines, came in. Now those machines, like 3D printer is one of those machines which are more precise in the manufacturing, and it doesn't require to be operated manually, because initially there were a lot of manual process needed. Now that machines are so good at work that it can do 5-axis CNC, it can do a lot of machining. You can see this graphics, this is a GIF. Now this machine is not only oriented toward a linear, but it has been more about 5-axis. It can work in angle, it can work in a horizontal plane also. So that can do a lot of machining, job work, and this increase a lot of industrial advantage, and also increased about creating more kind of parts, manufacturing units, and that advancement help us to create a lot of innovation and modification in our current day-to-day life by introducing lot of gadgets. So this is how the third industrial revolution, with combination of digital as well as with the combination of fabrication, started helping us. So sorry for disorientation of PPT, maybe it is resized, that's why. So now everything going digital, the current era, if you see, that is called as fourth industrial revolution. So in fourth industrial revolution, there are three most important part. One is data, second is decision, and third is devices. So you already know about different of this, you know, lot of products are being launched into the market now. So all of them use data, decision, and devices. So if you take an example of Uber, so Uber itself is a kind of an app which can help us to track taxis. It can bring us a vehicle. It can drop wherever the location we are keeping. But all of those things use devices, which is our mobile. Now, when we send our data over GPS signal with our secondary data, which is where we need to go, it start taking decision about what car is near. And that is all happening automated by using lot of algorithms. And this all thing are statistical data, which has been fed constantly to many of this Uber drivers. So this is how it is helping us in transport. Now, if you see in health, the same way Arogya Setu app, you all know, which has been very helpful in COVID to track a lot of people. And it was been help us to get right kind of vaccination center and where we need to get test. So all this thing happened because of this technologies are already been developed. Companies like FMCG, Grofers, Big Basket, all of them are using this for listing their products. And those products have been reaching, they've been used QR scan codes, lot of things. Same in Google Maps. The Google Map is expanding into villages also now. Due to the devices that has been increased in villages, it is easy to track which road are motorable, which road are just for pedestrian. So all this thing, the data is helping us to develop this kind of products. And these products are helping us. And every product is now getting more onto digital. And not only digital, with the data, where the internet plays very important role. So how this thing works? So basically, in fourth industrial revolution, we are going to cover more about artificial intelligence. And AI is enabling a lot of things around us. So what is AI and what AI can do? So machine, whatever machine is, we feed data or data set to that machine. So this particular data set can be anything. Like if we want to predict about rainfall, then that data set would be wind, temperature, pressure, humidity, and the orientation of clouds taken from the satellite picture. So this particular data given onto a particular data set, now an algorithm will run a particular understanding, like with what data the rain happened. So let's say if this set of data was there with this particular value, then on that day rain was there. So now from that particular thing, then algorithm will start doing calculation and analysis. And now whenever in future, the certain kind of data has been again going to be created or it's been there, the computer will start predicting and saying, okay, there are chances of rain will happen. Now, if there are two conditions, either the rain will happen or not happen. So if the rain happened, from that particular prediction, computer will start learning, okay, with my this data, the rain happened. And if this data, the rain did not happen, the next time the computer itself will learn from that data and will not announce or not predict that rain will come with this particular data. So each and everything has been interconnected, automated, and it can be scaled for any particular numbers. So it can be for 1 lakh data or it can be for 10 lakh data, because the computer are been so advanced now that they can do this kind of calculations. So AI has three main domains. So among those three main domains, how that particular thing work, I'll explain few of them. So this is particular domain called statistical data, where we have lot of numbers, alphanumerical, all those things can be analyzed by a machine. And that machine can help us to predict like what things can be happened, or it can also help us to find some pattern. So here, the machine has been fed by data of rising sea level, as well as the data of height of land above the sea level with its altitude. So this is a map of Mumbai, in which the machine has predicted like by 2050, due to rise in sea level by global warming, this red area would be flooded. So this coastal flooding will cover this much red area, and it need to be relocated, or it need to be find some solution to avoid this. So many of the people living in this red area are been into danger zone by 2050. So this is how this machine can predict from its statistical data. Now, the second part of this artificial intelligence is computer vision. So you all know, like if you are working in Python, there are certain libraries like OpenCV and all, which help you to do the computer vision programming. Now, if you see Google Translate app, this Google Translate app can read any of the text and it can translate the same thing, putting the same background color. So it's much easier for reading and give it to you instantly. So here the written language is in Russian and that has been translated to English. And that too with the help of computer vision technology, where the color separation, whatever the color is, that can be identified by a machine. And that machine particularly help us to identify what particular thing has been written there. So after computer vision, the next particular thing with whatever we would be saying is an Alexa or Google Home is about natural language processing, where this NLP can listen to us. And as soon as they listen to us, they convert that particular thing into text form and start storing that particular thing into database. Now, from that particular thing, they learn what we are asking, what things we like, what things we did not like, what kind of songs we like to listen, and kind to learn what suggestions they can provide it to us. So this is how the natural language processing can recognize our speech as well as our local languages. So currently, if you see, Google and Alexa can recognize Hindi language also. Earlier, it was only English. So now they're developing a kind of system which can go towards local languages, and sooner you can find all Marathi, Telugu and Tamil languages supported by this kind of devices in future. So as we discussed earlier, the statistical part of data, Arogya Setu was one of the most important app during COVID, and that helped us to monitor the cluster. A lot of notifications were sent, like that there are this many of cases near you by this many of distance. Then self-assessment can be done, like I have taken a test where they will ask, okay, how much days you have traveled, have you been outside, what kind of sickness you are feeling. So through that, they can also get certain data and we can also get verified whether we should need to go to a doctor or not. So this all thing has been utilizing technology, which has been covering artificial intelligence in it. So what is the fourth industrial as a industrial revolution as a combination? So internet IoT is the most important part as a part of devices, which has been having a lot of sensors in it, and it connects through different devices to communicate. But majorly, there are three main communication. One is human to human communication. Second is human to machine communication. And third is machine to machine communication. So currently, in IoT, this machine to machine communication, which are number of devices around us in our house, has been taking a lot of data. And according to that data, it helps us to automate things. The second part in industrial revolution would be more about robotics and automation into industries. So a lot of automation will be introduced. If you go back earlier, the lift, let's say we have a 5-story building, then we initially used to have a lift which we need to handrail ourselves, close it and open it. Then the sensor-based system came where the doors will close automatically and open automatically. So this is how slow advancement is there. But now, if you think about Amazon itself, so Amazon is creating a lot of shipments every day. So those shipments as a part of their delivery ecosystem has a lot of automation. So if this automation is there, then and then only they can scale their business or economy up to that level. So this robotics and automation help us into this particular domain. Now VR. So VR has been still advancing, but currently the level of advancement which I have seen into products is, if you want to repair a tractor, you are at your village and you don't know much about the tractor. If you wear a VR kind of a HoloLens where you can see through it, but still it can give you a recognition of what part it is and how to repair it. So this kind of technology as a VR will help us to do a lot of things. It can also help us to teach people more about repairing things, more about exploring, analyzing the data in front of them. And you have seen much about VR technology in Iron Man also. So in Ironman, the Jarvis is specifically analyzing the area and then giving out. So combination of computer vision as well as the showcase, like output as in VR and AR, is going to be more realistic and easy to use in our current world. And last one is AI, where I said three important things: statistical data, computer vision, and NLP. Combination of all of those things is being covered as a fourth industrial revolution. And as we have seen earlier, the number of jobs coming in the next 5 years are being related to all of this four segment. So now, as I was talking about, the first thing which we have seen is a motor. Okay. After motor, we have seen there are different kind of motor developed right now: brushless, DC motor, gear motors, all of those things have been developed till now. Now, adding a computer vision, which is an AI part, onto that motor enables the same machine to do a lot of creative jobs, and that also with the low skill set. So let's say a kid want to cut a particular size of a wood with the precision. Now, with the help of this particular machine, they can do it. But that is only possible when they are using AI-based technology, where the computer vision play important role for cutting this particular thing. So let's say how this particular thing works. So if you can see the slide, the one thing is spindle. So spindle is basically a device where there is a drill bit and it rotates very fast. So it helps us in the cutting part. Now, in the screen, if you can see, there is a blue line and a white line in the center. So you have to just take the machine there. So according to the line out, the machine will rotate into particular free area and cut the same size. So now you have to just take something near where you need to have a cut. Rest, machine will be more precise with the help of the computer vision technology built in it. So how computer vision technology works, like how it knows like this is the area and this is how it is. So they have a patented technology of this dot matrix. You can see there are dots onto the tapes. So with the help of that dot, this machine can recognize where is the precise position of it. So with that particular precise position, it will cut that particular part only. So this is the technical advantage which we are getting it right now. And these machines are being used widely right now. And I have seen this machine in 2018. So 2018 and 2021 is a much 3 year gap. And now there will be much more machines coming up with the same technology into the market. So this is how the advancement in technology from the motor from Nikola Tesla has been reached over here with adding more innovation in it. So you can see, yes, here you can easily understand this is how the machine works. So this is the thing. It is like you have to just input, then you just take the tool over here. It will only cut the path which has been designed. So it will automatically cut the corrected part and then it will complete your project. So you can see the design, like there is a square, there is a cut in the center where they need to fill the black and white part. So they just put machine there and they are cutting the way the design has been input. And they have to just hold the machine. The spindle will move automatically. There is one more example which I would like to take in this is how we can miniaturize the advancement of technology and utilize that particular thing in day-to-day life. So all of you have seen a pen, like you know that the pen is one of the most important part as a student. Now, why I have taken example of the pen is to define what is a miniaturization of the technology and how much small it can be and how much impactful it can be. So here, this is the ordinary pen and you can see there is a Neo Smart Pen N2. So these are the pen which is having AI based technology where they are doing some computer vision algorithms to whatever you are writing that converts into digital. So this is how they are running into different technological advancement into this such small size. So what is Neo Smart Pen 2? Smart Pen N2? It has been specific like conventional pen, but it used Bluetooth technology as well as computer vision to record whatever you are writing and convert that into a digital text. It used Bluetooth 4.0 LE, low energy Bluetooth, and it has a dual mode supporting, and you can easily connect it with your mobile. So there are two patent which they are been using. So this is one of them. So with Encode technology, they have developed a particular small kind of crisscross pattern onto the special paper which they are providing. So this particular symbols which has been crisscross define the precise point where your nib is going to touch, and according to your drawing or according to your writing, this particular nib will digitalize the particular marking, whatever you are doing on the paper, into digital form. So how this particular thing work? As I said, there is a camera beneath the nib. You can see there is a hollow structure there, and that hollow structure has a camera which sees the crisscross pattern on the paper, and from there it takes the point, and whenever you pressure the point, it start calculating the stroke and start creating that digital line outs. Its design is very well, a good pen hold, and it is same size of a pen. It is the dimensions, the technology used in it. So you can see there is a proper Android OS has been used. Then it has been taken as like, if you use it constant, like if you're writing it, the battery time is for 5 hours, and the standby time is 125 days, and the full charge will take 2 hours. So the design has been made according to the user requirement. Now, whatever you were writing, like onto the pen or pad, okay, so that particular thing has been digitalized into AI, which is Adobe tool, and Photoshop also. So now you can easily take those characters, paint it very well into a graphical designer software, and now you can export the same thing into SVG, which can be also used on website development and all. So this is really helpful for graphic designers and the people who are taking notes. Now, as I said, this pen is also using it used to record whatever you speak, and it also create that particular file in MP3, so you can easily hear it out also. Now, one more technology which you will understand over here is, whatever you are writing, the same computer vision technology which has been implemented through a camera, it can be same implemented through a nib also, where if you write I, so the black and white color which is differentiating the letter can be recognized by a computer on the pixel based formula, and by that particular thing it can convert that particular thing into type. So whatever you have written onto the paper, you can get it typed into a software in your mobile. So this is how the transcribe of the text which you are writing, handwritten notes, can be got through digital text. So it is coming with the standard refill and all. Now, this was the one part. Second part is only one slide which I want to cover, and this is one of the last slide as requested by sir, and we have less time. We have reduced the 15 minute time with the delay, so I'm just cut down the part. Yes. Now Starlink, you all know, you are all fan of Elon Musk, if you are, I am one of them, but now Starlink is going to provide the disk, like, which is like one of their venture, and that particular thing will increase the number of devices into rural ecosystem as well. So currently the saturation of devices in urban ecosystem, where cities like Mumbai, Pune, Hyderabad, Delhi, and Bangalore is much, but the same thing will increase into rural ecosystem also, which will increase the technological demand for rural need, like agriculture, transportation, and all. So there will be a lot of innovation coming in rural ecosystem also, because now initially any user want to take internet from direct satellite was much hard. Now, with the introduction of Starlink kind of devices and products, easily anyone from rural area can directly get internet. And it has been worth, because the amount of speed which they are providing is fair enough. It is 103 Mbps at anywhere in the world. It is though some costly, but it can be still solve the purpose where the internet can be implemented into farms to do a lot of IoT agriculture based devices, running a LoRa network. So LoRa network is a low powered, high range system which work on frequencies to collect the data. So those kind of innovations will come into the market. So the summary of the entire session, which I would like to give, is if you really want to understand AI, then you need to start focusing on what user need, and according to that user, what are the technologies coming up into the market. I tried to explain you the history and the future, wherever the products are going towards. As I had a very less time, I thought this would be the one of the most important part to cover. So I tried to cover this, and the last slide which I kept intentionally was to give you that now if cities have been saturated with internet, the next internet expansion would be into rural. And for that, the product like Starlink will play a very important role. And due to that, there will be a lot of job opportunities or innovation or product opportunities into rural ecosystem, where you can think about the problem statement. And now internet is not the limitation in rural with such kind of products. So there will be such products available in India also in next 5 years. So thinking internet reaching into rural, a lot of innovation can happen. And specifically India being 70% into rural ecosystem, 70% people into rural need certain things. And with help of NLP and computer vision, the language barrier, which was there earlier, will be reduced a lot. Like a lot of phones and everything will be coming up with the local language options. It can also detect your local languages, Gujarati, Hindi, Marathi, whatever you speak. So it can help you to do certain tasks or help you to run certain application. So this was all about awareness and upgradation, which you need to think of. So, and now I am open for Q&A session. So thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now we would like to ask a few of the questions which has been set up, which has been asked by our viewers. Okay. So the first question, Dhruv sir, what they have asked is there, apart from the examples what you have shown, is there any other example where we can really apply the artificial intelligence in our day-to-day life? That's one more example what they want.
So see, you can see artificial intelligence implementing in everywhere. So I will give you a very simple example, which was I got from Australia. So there was a researcher from Australia, and the lady came up with a simple size of a visiting card, size of a paper. Now, I did not remember exactly, but at that time I thought of implementing AI in it. So I have my mobile, okay? And this mobile can take colors easily. So if I dispatch that particular one visiting card size of papers to a lot of villages across India, let's say there are 18,000 villages in Gujarat. And if you think about UP, it is 1 lakh. So moreover, a lot of lakhs of villages are there in Gujarat and all over India. Now, if I want to find out where the mosquitoes with malaria and other parasites are growing, and I need to track them much easily, I can put that card outside my home into a small can or small box. And it has certain fragments where mosquito will come and sit on it. So as soon as it sits on it, there will be certain color composition where if there is certain parasite, it will show some color indication. That was the innovation by that Australian lady. So if I can get a color from there, and any person, and each and every visiting card has a tag which has been giving the location identity, as well as the mobile application which will be provided to user, it has a location capacity. Now if I have at my home, at my village, I find out, okay, there are some mosquitoes which has been said there are blue color, red color, and green color. I click the picture and submit it to an online system. Now that online system use artificial intelligence, analyze the card and identify what kind of parasite would be there. And according to that parasite or according to that insect identification, they can run programs for removing that insect. And that is how the malaria can be controlled. And you will be surprised, the amount of people dying by malaria is more and more rather than dying by weapons or dying by anything else. So malaria and mosquito is one of the most dangerous enemy for the human right now, and that need to be controlled. So by a very simple implementation of AI, we can track where the malaria is been spreading and how we can reduce it. So we can easily implement teams or implement equipments to reduce that parasite. So this is how a simple implementation you can think of. And I'm working with one of the student, Costa, who is from Jamshedpur on this, but he's currently working for some other project. So soon we'll be pitching this project in AI also.
Thank you. Thank you. We have in the meantime, we have received another question. Here the student wants to ask, how safe is our data? Because artificial intelligence is all about data, right? So how safe is our data when we give this kind of stuff to any kind of artificial intelligence being incorporated? So how safe it is?
So if you think about safety or privacy of the data, now considering if you're using an Android phone and you're using many of the applications, then privacy is the myth. Basically, it records a lot of our voice. Even if I'm taking this session right now, I'm using an Android phone, then it and I have given allow access to a lot of my application as they can take my voice, then they are recording that voice and converting into text regularly. And they are taking the keywords out of it, and they're using this keyword to share me that advertisement, share me certain kind of thing which can be benefited to our business model. So each and everywhere your data is been exposed in a different way. Even if you think about how security works, then security and data is two different aspects. So let's say a bank use their internal servers. It is not on internet, it is on intranet. So the safety of a bank is much more better than our mobile phone based application. Because our mobile phone based application, the data is more on public servers, it is exposed to a lot of people, and it is multiple websites which are collecting the data. If the cookies, if you install in your this Chrome, that is also collecting a lot of data. So first is what type of data it is collecting. The second is how it has been utilized. And third is whether there is an option to delete or to stop it being used. So I have started thinking this a long before, and I am not using Chrome as such for more time. I usually use Brave sometime. So Brave is more about it doesn't share data to anyone. And I usually read a lot of pitches, like where the startup pitch. So there is one startup which is going to pitch a new kind of a browser where they pay you for using your data, and they also say for what purpose your data has been used. So this kind of new businesses are coming into the market where everyone know our data has been used for certain work, because it is never free. But now the browsers are going to be there which will pay us according to our data. So that will be more better, because we know that this browser is using my data and they are paying us the 80% of their income, and they are keeping the 20% of their cut. So this is how the new startups are evolving around your safety about the data and giving more transparency.
Okay, thank you.
And if you are more worried, you can see a movie called Eagle One. So the capacity of Eagle One, whatever has been seen, apart of handling the equipment directly by a machine, rest all the data is similar. Like you can, the next 20 years, machines can easily track us from my home to my office and it can take it. But if the servers are same, then only. If let's say Ahmedabad CCTV monitoring system is been intranet, it is not on internet, then anybody sitting on US cannot hack it, because it is on a separate ecosystem, separate internal server. So until this particular things are separate, then you are not much worried about. But it is through the internet. Like if I am using Alexa, it is through the internet. And if there is not encryption done in between the data, then your data has been exposed.
So throughout this session, we have heard about the positive of artificial intelligence. So now I have a question with me where the student is asking, any technology we are going to adopt, it is going to have its positive side as well as negative side. Can you just foresight some of the negative sides of this artificial intelligence?
See, artificial intelligence as a negative side, I don't see much because the amount of problems around us is so huge. And to solve those problems with the incredible accuracy, AI is much needed. So if I say TV is good or bad, okay? So if it is according to our use, if we use it for only entertainment, it is not good. But if we use to watch documentaries and everything, it is good. So AI being a good at a part where it solves problem, but nowadays a lot of people are using AI for their business design. Like they use AI to track the customer. They use AI to, you know, basically increase their sales and everything. And they know where to pinpoint. So due to that, a lot of economy will also be directly affected due to the use of AI. Second is a lot of job reduction will be there. And the job reduction as a negative part, which I have seen as I used to work in rural ecosystem, a lot of people in rural ecosystem may lose the job because they don't have an opportunity to learn. They don't get a right quality education. So due to not having the right quality education, the machine will come and replace them. And they are helpless because they don't even have an awareness about what is happening in the outside world. Like I am recently taking sessions into extreme poverty line, like tribal areas, about AI itself. And they have never seen Alexa. They have never seen a Wi-Fi operated bulb. They don't even know about this kind of machine exists because they are into their own domain and own area. So the negative part could be if the people are not upgrading themselves, the people would be more about labor community and all will suffer a lot because advancement will not change them and they will be, you know, exploited with kind of labor system from industry and all. And that might be the most important negative point. Second is AI can also build for creating harm to ecosystems. Where if I implement a system which can go to certain website, let's say a hacker can use AI to disrupt the entire website. So it can run an engine which will go to certain website, run some algorithm and find loopholes. And it can blackmail those particular websites saying, if you don't pay this much money, I will just corrupt your website. And that is much easier, as I have seen certain security layers that can be done through AI. So AI being a automated system can go through 2 lakh of website in one day and list 5,000 website which are vulnerable. And a person is just sitting in his chair and drinking his coffee. And he has to just put enter to send the email. So the negative part of AI is this kind of automation can also increase the capacity of people like hackers.
Okay. So I could find many questions are piling up. And I'll take few of them. It is asking, one of the students is asking, the NeoPen N2 can translate voice into text. Then it can only translate English generated voice, or it can translate all the languages into text.
So if you see recently, Alexa has came up with the voice of Amitabh Bachchan also. And the same way, like before a year, there was only English language available in Alexa. Now Alexa can listen to Hindi also. So slowly they are trying to train this particular machine into different languages. But for training the machine itself, they are using our voice itself. So when we are saying something and if Alexa is unable to understand, then that goes to some manual kind of system where this has been matched and trained. So whatever questions this machine cannot understand in local languages are being personally taken care by people initially to make the machine understand it is asking for this. And that is how this technology works. So by next 3 to 5 years, you will be able to see a lot of local language of India will be added to this kind of machines. But currently, I have seen Hindi and English working very well with NLP.
Okay. And in fact, this would be a stepping stone for all the students who are watching this. Suppose this is Odisha, and anybody watching, any student watching from here, he can try to develop the Oriya language that they can take up as a task also, if possible. So moving to the next one, it is asking that what is the difference between artificial intelligence and a software?
Okay, so software, I am using it from where I have, from when I have computer. Like I have seen the first computer in 2004. So in 2004, there was a Microsoft Office. So, but at that time, AI was not been implemented. Software, so AI, software is a kind of a book and the chapter is AI. So software is what which you can install, like in library, you can keep a book, in computer, you can install a software. But it is all about what is written in the software, and that can be called as an AI. So AI is a kind of technology. It's and it, each technology has a different version. So software is an installation process and or installation copy. But in the software, what it is and how it works, that can be AI, that can be machine learning, that can be a simple program for Notepad, or it can be Arduino or anything.
Okay, thank you. And one more question. What is your views on Neuralink, whether it is beneficial or not? Somebody has sent this Neuralink.
I have not researched very well on Neuralink right now. Okay, so lot of things have been inventing, and I am more onto rural development, so I need to do a research. You can contact me back. I will do that research by today itself and give you the answer back. So I have just Googled it right now, and it is more about, okay, Elon Musk working on it, OpenAI. Okay, I will research very well. I can understand the brain machine interface which they are writing, but I will exactly give you the answer later on.
So what I'll do is I will just share. Can I share your email ID with all my students who have joined, so that if they have further queries, they can disturb you at some point of time.
So I'll be more available on my Discord. I will give you my Discord ID, because which I'm using openly for every communication. So that will be much better.
Okay. So I will do that once it is over. So due to some time constraint, we have to move on. I would like to thank you, sir, for showing our audience the bridge between the era of sensors and AI. Indeed, our students must have understood the importance of AI in the 21st century. Okay, so moving to the next topic, we all are aware that all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. So now it's playing time, but we are not going to play outdoor games. Rather, we are going to play an indoor game with papers. As all of you must be aware of origami, which is folding of papers into decorative shapes and figures. To have a hands-on experience on this, I would like to invite our next speaker, Mr. Tej Patel, who is a 12th grade student, an origami enthusiast, and have been participating in it for over 10 years. He is now working on applying origami to different materials and forms and exploring the more technical side of origami. He has participated in many competitions, and his models got selected in many conferences, including Origami USA, multiple times. So now over to you, Mr. Tej.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, it's an honor to be over here. And thank you for the very generous introduction. Let me start off by, first of all, sharing my screen itself. So just wanted to know if my screen is visible.
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So like to put origami as in sense, like what if I say the word origami? Most of you would visualize something like a paper boat, a cootie catcher, or a paper plane. Like that's what the origami we know from now. Like till now, we have just folded things out of paper, and that was origami for us. But let's just once get to know about origami in detail, what it is actually about. So technically speaking, origami comes from two words. It is a Japanese art, so it comes from two Japanese words, which is oru the word for folding, and kami is the word for paper. So it literally means just folding paper. So that cuts out that we cannot cut anything from the paper or use glue in it. So it is just folding paper to make things. Now, it has been going on from since ages. Like once the paper was invented, many of the people thought that what if we fold paper into some different forms? And that's how origami started. And this is one person I would like to highlight. His name is Akira Yoshizawa. So we can say that he is the Elon Musk for origami. Like as Dhruv sir just said, we can
sorry
compare.
To interrupt. Yes, can sir? You make the screen full screen? I mean the PPT which you are showing. Is it possible?
Is it not visible full screen right now?
It's visible. Actually, if you can play it in the full screen. So.
Okay, I'll just try to do
can
it.
Can you make the slide show?
Okay, yeah. I'll try to do it. Is it better now?
Okay, you can continue.
Okay. So yes, I was on Akira Yoshizawa. So he is like the Elon Musk of past. So he did something to origami, which transformed it into an art form. From literally just a craft of folding paper, he transformed it into a living art. So he gave something very important, which is a language. Language is very important to transcend knowledge down the line. So this is a language of lines, folds, and some arrows. So by looking at this, you can see if I tell you to fold a paper, you can either fold it in a mountain fold or valley fold. So these are some basics. Now you must all be thinking that what is a craft form doing here? We are celebrating such advancements in technology, AI, ML. What is this small art doing over here? Yes, sorry for the slight inconvenience. Yeah. So what is origami doing in this highly robotic or like in this smart age over here? So let's have a look at some of the applications of origami. Like that way you can know better where origami is being used. So one of the applications of origami is in space. You see that there are solar panels being sent to space. So if solar panels are generally huge in surface area, so if we need to put it in a rocket, we need to fold it. Otherwise, we cannot send it to space. So that's where origami helps. It helps in making the solar panel compact so that it can easily go up in space. Then it is used in healthcare, right? We are now moving towards such surgeries where cuts are very minimal. So like instead of a surgeon doing cut on my body and then working on the tissues inside me, there would be a small robot which would be indigested by me, and that robot would do the surgery inside my body. So the mechanic working principle of those robots, those minuscule robots, are working on the base of origami. Then there are airbags in our cars. So whenever an accident happens, the airbag need to open up in a split second. Like there isn't even a reaction time, but the airbag open up and they are folded very compactly in the steering wheel of the car. So that's where origami is used. Like it is literally being folded such tiny, but it can open up in a millisecond. So that's another use of origami. And now, like, there are lots of things about things that humans cannot do, but robots can do. Like, there is lifting weights. So in factories, there are lots of stuff that need to be moved around and lots of stuff need to be worked on. So these origami robots, what they do is they are very highly light in weight. So what it helps is that it can be easily transported and it has very low maintenance, because at end it just has a frame and a fabric or a simple skin like material on it. Now, this is like one example of origami where it is being used as robotics. So this was something interesting I came across. And you must all have seen those videos on Facebook where we where there is a bed which can fold up into the wall, or there is a TV which can be converted into a table. So that way, it is space management. It is all about how compact we can make our lives. So it is one region where we can completely fold a solid rigid form into a smaller space. And buildings, like this is a small example from a building in Dubai. So what it is basically there are facades all over the building, and during daytime the facades will actually close up, so that way it allows most sunlight to come in. But during the afternoon, when the sunlight is really harsh, it will open the flaps. You can see the mathematical design of the flaps. So that way it can completely allow the sunlight to come in and completely break it also. So it can give shade as well. So I just wanted to let you guys know about a brief of origami. That way you can sort of connect that, yes, this origami, like this paper plane or paper boat, is connecting to somewhere at a higher level. Now, I would like to just show some categories of origami. That way we can get much familiar to the art form in itself. So this is action. So action origami is something where after you have folded one model, there is some sort of movement in the finished item. As most of you might have made a paper jumping frog. So we know that it simply converts the, like we give it some energy and it jumps off. So that's action origami. I will show you some more examples of action origami after some time. Then there is modular origami. So remember we talked about there are no cuts and glue in this origami, but we can use multiple papers and interlock them so as to get a form which is bigger in size, and we can also play around with colors in it. So it is modular origami. Then wet folding. This is something which is quite abstract. It is quite similar to sculpting a paper. So we basically dampen the paper with a wet cloth and then sculpt it with our hands. So you can see that we can get very organic forms out of it. These are generally used to make animals or natural objects. Then there comes a mathematical side to origami. So these are some tessellations. So tessellations basically are that there is a motif or a single pattern, and then that pattern keeps on repeating itself. So it makes up a tessellation. You might have seen the footpath pavement. So that has a simple block, and that block keeps on repeating. So it is a sort of tessellation. Then fractals. This is something which quite fascinates me. So you can see in the images, like this is a fractal. So basically a small motif or a small pattern, it completely keeps on enlarging in size, but the form of the object, the basic design remains the same. So these are some origami fractals. And then comes the basic origami, which was like to make a paper boat or a paper plane. It is pure land origami. So this is origami in its raw form. When there were not many complex origami introduced, this was what people used to make with origami. And this is origami of the present age. What if I told you that the tarantula over here with 8 legs and two antennas is made from a single piece of paper without cutting, without gluing. That's quite fascinating to me, at least. So these are complex origamis. Like, first, the basic origamis have some folds around 15 to 20 folds, but this origamis have more than thousands, 2,000s, 20,000s folds. So this is what we have come to till now, and people are making even more complex forms with it. Now, these are some miscellaneous categories of origami, which I would like to mention. So there's this giant origami. So people make almost lifelike structures. This is a photo of Himanshu Agrawal with his folded elephant. You can see that it's quite similar to a real elephant in size. Then there's dollar origami. So dollar is quite a fascinating paper. You can fold it many times, but it doesn't tear or give off its color. And the other thing about dollar is its dimensions. Its paper's dimensions are quite unique, which allow it to make many different things with it. Then there comes miniature origami, which is quite the opposite of giant origami. So it's like microscopic foldings. Then infinite origami, or these are some forms which keep on rotating. So it's something like flexagons, but more on a three-dimensional level. Then it's used in jewelry design. Like, it is definitely a huge part in design creations. Like, most of the ideologies for sculptures come from origami. Like, the first raw version of a sculpture is made using some papers or raw materials like it. Then there are applications of origami in different materials. Like, I am exploring upon applying origami to wood, to metal, to, like, I have tried folding origami with fabrics. So these are some more categories of origamis. Now, enough with talking. I would like to show you some of the models which I have made, just so you can get to know about a better idea about origami. So I will just stop sharing my screen and I will switch my camera. Is my desktop webcam visible? I hope so. My desktop webcam is visible. So let's start off with action origami. This is the thing which fascinates me quite a lot. So this is a magic ball. So as to see the magic, if I can, you can see that I can roll it in the form of a tube very easily. But if I pressurize the two ends of it, it opens up very beautifully. And this is used in medical science. So we all know about nerves and arteries and veins in our body. So arteries and veins in our body, sometimes they got blocked due to blood clots. So to open those clots, there is a small device named stent. So what it does is, it goes inside the vein like this, and on the point of blockage where there is some contraction happens, it opens up so as to make the blockage open, and it allows the blood flow again. So this is an example of application of origami. Then let's have a look at this simple thing. Like, in most of our ATLs, we have a spring. What if I told you that this spring is just made from paper? There is no mechanical thing inside. It is just paper, which is allowing this motion to happen. And you can also see that how this layers of paper are actually alive, allowing the motion to happen. Remember I told about solar panels back then? So this is the design which they had used to send solar panels. So basically it goes up to space like this, and in space it opens up very easily like this. So this design had to be that simple that a robot can open this solar panel in zero gravity without any human interference. So this was the design they got finalized with. Being in ATLs, most of you have worked with 7-segment displays. So what they are is we use them to display numbers. Now, this is a small type of 7-segment display which I have tried to make. So if I want to display the number 1, I can display the number 1 like this. And all of these individual flaps can be controlled very easily. If I want to make a 6, oh, this is the opposite 6. Yeah. If I want to make 6, so I can easily make any number with this. So the things we can do with origami are countless. So let's have a look at some more different things. This is an example of origami fractal. So remember I told that the same pattern, it keeps on repeating and increasing in size. Now, this is called a flower tower. So you can see that it is 2-dimensional in form right now, but I can simply increase the stages of this like a tower. So this is stage 1, this is stage 2, this is stage 3. So you can see that it transformed from a 2D shape to a 3D form really quickly. And now, just to prove that this is in fact made from a single piece of paper, I can open this. Now the thing with paper is it has memory. It remembers where it was folded. So what it will do is it will try to go back in its original form. And that way we can have the 2D flower back. Then this is an origami snake. So you can see that it is quite flexible. And this flexibility which it has right now is actually very flexible than most robots have degrees of freedom. So this robot, this snake pattern have been used to actually create robots. Remember the robot I showed you guys in the beginning? It had a quite similar pattern regards to this shape, to this snake. So yeah, we can quite take inspirations from origami models directly and apply them in real world really easily. Let me show you some more mathematical side of origami. So this is an example of a fractal. You can quite significantly see that the small flower keeps on repeating itself. And this is an example of origami tessellation. So you can have a look that this small hexagonal pattern is repeating all over the space. And it is quite an intrigue work. Like you can see the paper being weaved into itself. So these are some things which have taken quite long time for me to make. And then there is this form which I quite enjoy. So this is flat to begin with, but once it has something, some form in it, it actually takes the shape of that form. And that way it can actually mimic the form of a solid object. So this can be applied somewhere in real world as well. So these were just some ideas, like some things I came up with. And yeah, why not origami in nature? You might be familiar with the 7 wonders of the world. One of them is Machu Picchu. Those are some towers shaped sort of similar to this. So you can see that this is quite a replica of that. And there's a lot of mathematical things going behind as well. You can see that each of these layers are stages, and I can keep on increasing the stage if I have a bigger paper. There's this one interesting application, like example of fractal itself, but this is quite different. So what if I told you that there are 16 flowers, right? Each of these flowers can open into a box. I can take any random flower and open it into a box. But the interesting part begins when I say that these two or any two in a group are actually box in itself too. So I can open any group of two and those are box. Now, what if I told you that each pair of four is also a box? So you get the idea of it. So it can be a box at a much higher scale, and the same thing repeats on a bigger scale as well. So this is referred to as Zen book or something that infinite book. And yeah, this is an example of modular origami. I think so in class 10th, we studied about carbon and its allotropes. So this is an example of one of those allotropes, carbon C60 or Buckminster fullerene. You can see the structure is quite similar to that. All of these intersections are points of carbons, and these lines between them are bond pairs. So we can relate it to chemistry as well. Now, how about we make an example of DNA also out of it? So this is like something related to biology I wanted to share. So just we can also make DNA from it. And I tried to learn about how DNA structures work and how data is stored in them. But that's a whole different research. Then origami can be found in nature as well. Like there is like we discover shells on the beaches, right? So this is an example of shell folded from paper. You can see that it quite mimics the nature of a shell, how the folds are there. And it also integrates the Fibonacci series. So you can see that this triangle sort of make a Fibonacci spiral. Now, like then there's fun side to origami too. Like how about a clapping monkey? So this is something made from paper and it can clap very easily. So there's always some fun also to it. And then comes modern origami, or like, I just want to share that it can be quite abstract as well. So I can show you this frog and the amount of detail it has. It has even toenails. So we can achieve quite natural looking forms, but still complex with origami only. And we can play around with colors as well. So this is again a single piece of paper. The paper was black on one side and yellow on other side. So I calculated and folded it as such so that we can have the correct colors on the correct places. And this is an origami pangolin. So this is one of the most complex works which I have done till date. And I just wanted to share a small fact that these are one of the most highly poached animals in the world. So their scales, you can see that each individual scale is a different flap of paper. So those scales are actually made from keratin, same thing which our nails are made from. And those are used in medical purposes. So just this is an example of quite natural but mathematical creature. So yeah, I'm sure most of you might be fascinated like with origami by now. So let's get some papers and do something hands-on only. So I would request all of you to maybe have a sheet of rectangular paper if you have some lying around, and we can start off with making something which will be useful to you in your day-to-day life. So yes, I assume most of you are ready with your papers and we can start the folding process. So the first step towards like to make origami is to have an open mind. So just have a blank surface and start folding with me. So we'll take the top of the paper and fold it to the bottom edge. We are essentially folding the paper half vertically. Along the way with folding, I will also be marking these fold lines just to make things more visible. So So this is the first fold we made, which is folding the paper in half. Now, the second fold is quite similar. We need to fold the paper in half again. Just make sure that the paper's flaps don't get out of the way and try to be as precise as possible. It actually helps to make the finished product look better. So you can see that there's some maths involved in it too. Like, we have divided the paper in four itself without the use of taking any measurements. So this was our second fold. Yeah, I will just, yeah. So now the next fold would be something we all have done. It is like, you can simply take this line and try to make an airplane from it. So the fold would be to take the top corners and align it with this line. So you will get a very right angle triangle over here. The same thing on the other side as well. Now you will notice that there are two flaps in the bottom region. So we need to only take one of these flaps and fold it to the top part. So it's quite similar to the top fold, but we are taking only one flap of paper. The other flap remains on the ground, and same on the other side as well. I'll again just mark this folds. So these are our four folds. Now, the next step is, we will take this flap and we will fold it towards the top. So what it will do is, it will lock the four triangles which we have made. So that way, this whole part becomes a clean surface again. And you will see that this, in fact, becomes a pocket. We can keep something over here if we want. Now is a very interesting part. So what we need to do is, we need to make a line which starts from here, the end of this triangle or hypotenuse, and then fold a line which starts from here towards the base. So what you will find that when you try to fold it, it will appear to be folding on itself. It is due to the hidden layers behind this paper. We need to fold this line and try to be as perpendicular to the base as possible. So you can do that by aligning the papers over here. And the same thing on the other side. So we will have something like this. I will also mark the second line. You will see that all these folds are very symmetrical. We can find angles of 90 degree or 45 degree all around the place. Now, the next step is something very interesting. So what we need to do is reach in and open this flap. And what we will be doing is, we have these two lines over here, right? Those are dented inside, or we refer to them as valley folds, which sort of make a valley like this, right? So what we need to do is, we need to pinch it and transform it into a mountain fold. So it will make it a mountain from a valley. And we need to do the same thing on the other side. So you will see that it sort of tries to generate a cuboidal form right now. Now, the next step, I will just allow a minute for everyone to continue the fold till here. And till then, I will prepare the lines for the next step. So you all can see that there are these two points over here. These are the intersection points of these horizontal lines. What we need to do is we need to fold a diagonal starting from here to this corner. And let me just draw a line to visualize. So we need to make this fold and the same fold on the other side as well. I'll use a scale over here. Yes. So we need to make these two folds into valley folds. So the simplest way you can do is if you bring this corner and this corner together, we'll see that the fold appears to fold on itself. The diagonal will appear. And then you simply need to pinch this part. It will make the diagonal fold possible. So you can see that the diagonal has been folded now. We will fold the same diagonal on the other side as well. So simply bring this and this corner together. And that folds the diagonal for us. So we will have something like two cats, two ears over here and a face. You can see that it quite resembles the face of a cat. So now the next step and the very last step of this origami model is we need to take this ear or flap, and there is a pocket over here. You can see that I can actually keep in something inside if I want to. So we take this flap and insert it inside this pocket. Now you can see that this flap has completely been inserted in it and it has locked it. We will do the same thing on the other side. So you can see that it has formed a quite sturdy but very simple box, and I see myself folding this every day. Like whenever I am at some place and don't have something to like quickly keep the things I have on my desk, I use this. So I'm sure it is quite much helpful to a student's life. We have pens lying all around and these help us all. And the best part is if you have multiple of them, you can make compartments with it. And that would make your table very organized. So yeah, and I'll leave something up to you that you can also flatten it to fold it so you can carry it around very easily. So I will just switch the camera and start sharing my screen again. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yes. So I'm sure you might have had fun making the box with me. Now, let us just have a look like what we all applied while doing the origami right now. So we saw lots of maths involved. We saw that there are straight lines, intersections of lines, different angles involved in it. So it actually helps to connect the logical part of your brain. So while folding, you will see that you are trying to be as precise as you can. And you are trying to match that corner to this corner. So it helps develop the logical part of the brain. Then it helps in hand-eye coordination. Like we find ourselves using phone most of the time, but these fingers are not getting the preciseness we wanted to. These hands are crafted very magically. Like we can use them with very much freedom. Like there's a lot of flexibility in our hands, then this increases our precision. Like in the era of reels or short video contents, our focus is being lost. Like we are not able to concentrate on something for more than more than a minute or half a minute. So this helps in developing that patience, that precision we need to have while our everyday life. And it definitely boosts your creativity and imagination. Like imagine just rolling up a piece of paper into a ball. And if you open it up, you will see hidden worlds in it. Like, so it also helps in boosting our creativity. Now, I would like to share a short story, like which has quite touched me. So there's a Japanese folklore or a saying that if you fold 1,000 paper cranes, like paper crane is something very generally referred to as a shape in origami. So if we fold 1,000 paper cranes, our wish comes true. So we all know about the devastating bombings that happens in Hiroshima, Nagasaki. So after those bombings, the radiations have affected people over there for years. So there was a small girl named Sadako Sasaki who was also affected by those radiations. She was only 6 years old, but she thought of folding 1,000 paper cranes for world peace. So that was such a strong message coming from such a person of small age. And that's what quite touched me. So she was unable to fold 1,000 paper cranes because she was unable to finish them, but her friends finished the 1,000 paper cranes and put them on her grave. And from that time, there is this tradition of folding 1,000 paper cranes for world peace and sending it to Japan. And I'm happy to share that I have already folded the 1,000 paper cranes twice, and right now I'm trying to make it for a third time. So these are some photos of me sharing the story of Sadako and being there with the 1,000 paper cranes. And apart from folding, like I love folding origami, but the next best thing for me is sharing origami. Like today I shared origami with all of you people. I have shared origami at different various places. So I would like to share, these are some photos of me teaching origami in Kashmir. And I love to see the gleam in the children's eyes when they see a paper coming to life in front of their eyes. Then these are some more pictures of me sharing origami, and it completely, like, it is quite surprising for me that people, when they are finished with origami, they just look at the thing they have made, and there is this sense of proud feeling that this is something I have made. And these are some more photos from, I love showing origami to people as well, so that people can know that origami is not just an art. It is not just the paper boat we make or a paper plane. There is much more to it. So yes, thank you all for listening to me and giving me this huge opportunity. It was quite amazing for me to teach origami or share my experience with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tej, for your splendid and lucid way of presenting different models. Actually, everybody here is just uttering the one single line, that is, Dil Mange More. That is, you should go on continuing showing us some new type of shapes so that we all should go on doing it. But due to time constraint, we have to stop here. Okay, so I have got many queries here, but these queries are much more related to your personal life. I would ask one of the questions which our student have asked, that at what age you started and to achieve such kind of fine-tuning, how much time it took?
So I was introduced to origami by my mother. Like most parents teach their children to fold a paper boat or a paper plane. But I found myself quite interested in paper planes. So by changing one of the folds, the paper plane's flying trajectory completely changed. Like if I make a thinner plane, it used to go far and fast. So that's what got into me into origami. So I was around 7 years of age. That's when I started origami. And I just turned 17 this month. So yeah, I have been doing it from around 10 years. And it's all about practice. Like the more you keep doing the same things, you keep working on your mistakes, the more better you get at it.
Thank you. And the next question is, are you planning up for some sessions more where our students can have their hands-on experience, like workshop related 1-2 more days? That's the question which has come up. Do you like?
I would love to do that. Like the next best thing about origami for me is sharing it. And I can also show you people how to design this sort of models. So if you have something in your mind, which you can visualize, and then I can share how to make it a reality and fold it from paper.
A kid has sent one question that, do you have any origami of different house patterns? I don't know why he asks. Do you have any house pattern which you can sew?
I don't particularly have a house pattern origami, but there is this structure used in origami. Let me just have a look. So while making suspension bridges, they use this sort of materials to see whether the bridges will take the load of those vehicles. So that way they don't actually fall down with excessive load. So this is quite beautiful in itself, and this has been used. So you can see if I increase the height of this, you can actually make an amphitheater out of it. And yeah, this is pretty much an example of an house. But definitely, I have some lying around, but I would need to search for that.
Next question, it is about any bird shape. They're asking, any bird shape you have that can be shown? I would answer more birds.
Okay, definitely I will. So some of you might be DC fans over here. So this is an origami bat trend. Then I can show something. This is an origami crane, or this is modified by me. So this is an example. And I don't know if this qualifies as a bird, but it's sort of a Pegasus. So Pegasus is a mythological creature which can actually fly. It's a flying horse. So this is a model of a flying horse. So yeah, these are some models of birds I have around here. This is a swan. I'm not sure if you can see, but this is a example of swan. So yeah, these are some birds I have.
So nice. So we'll take up the last question, which is a bit longer one. They're asking that, can they have a hands-on experience for another origami, which might be for 2-3 minutes. Is it possible in your part? Teach them one more.
Definitely. I can share one more model. I will. Should I do it right now?
Yes. Is it possible?
Yeah. Definitely. I will just switch my camera. I will take a paper. Okay, so I do have an A4 sized paper with me. We need a square for this model. I'm trying to make a toy which you can all play with all the time. So I will just make a square from this sheet of paper. And the simplest way to do is folding a diagonal and then cutting the excess rectangle out of it. So I'll simply cut this rectangle. So I will show the model. I will start with the model. So we need to fold the paper in half. And this is a square, so it doesn't matter if you do it horizontally or vertically. And once you have folded it, I'll just mark the center line. So we will do something which is quite similar to the paper plane. So we'll take the top two corners and fold it to this central line. So this is the top left corner, and let's take the top right corner. The next part of this origami is, you see that these two flaps end over here. But what we need to do is, we will take this top part and bring it a little bit below that. So we'll take it about 2 centimeters below from the dot and fold it. So you can see that it is this much away from the original line over there. So this is what we have folded. And now we will take the top edge and fold the bottom edge to it. Like, not this part, but we will fold it till here. This is where the apparent line is folding up. We'll take the top edge and fold it. Try that the paper doesn't slip around. So we have something like this. I'll just quickly show the folds again. We folded the top triangle little bit below than the line and folded the top edge to this line again. The next part is, we will take right edge of the paper and fold it to this central line. I'll just extend this line. So this is our central line. We will fold the right edge to this central line. And we will repeat the same on the other side as well. So this fold is called as a cupboard fold in technical terms in origami. And you will see that why it gets the name. So you can open it up and close it like a cupboard. That's why this is called a cupboard fold. Now I'll open this cupboard and mark these two folds. Yeah, so the last two folds of this model is to fold the bottom corners till this 1/4 mark or the cupboard fold lines. So we'll take this corner and fold it towards here and do the same thing on the other side. So this is our finished model, but you might be thinking, what is this and how is this a toy? So the last thing we need to do is maybe close the cupboards once with the triangles folded in. And let's have a look at it from the top. So you can open this cupboard at a 90-degree fold. So you will have something like this. And when you keep it on the ground, it will actually take a somersault. The name of this toy is a tumbling toy, or you can simply call it a somersault. So it will take a whole, just a second, I stopped it. It will take a whole somersault. This is due to that extra weight added over here. So yes, this is a simple toy we just made in about 5 minutes.
Thank you. That was so nice. So, Tej, I'm really grateful to you that you spent some time and enlightened our students about origami. Thank you. On the occasion of 4th Foundation Day of ATL, our club has organized an ideation to designing competition named ATL Kickstart 2021. In this, we have asked our students to give some innovative ideas. Many ideas came up, out of which an expert panel chose 5 best ideas of our school, irrespective of any order. Now, it's time to felicitate them. To do this honor, I would request our revered coordinator ma'am, along with all the supervisors present over here, to come up to the stage. Please, ma'am, and sir. With no specific order, I would now like to call Ankit Sarangi of 6B. Ankit, please come. Ankit Sarangi did a project on smart mobility, and the name of his project was Homemade Projector. He's from 6B. Moving to the next award, it is N.T. Sai Arup of 7C. He took up the project as Sensor Tram, where he has thought of using small sensors in the trams. Next, we have Ayushi Kara. He is a student of 8C, and she has designed an iCard which will have a GPS, which will tell the location of the students, as well as we can put money. The parents can put money in that iCard so that they don't the kids don't have to use cash in the canteen. A nice idea, Ayushi Kara of 8C. Next, I would like to call Kalim of 11A. He has given an idea under the name Travelator. I would request all the students, those who are getting prizes here, not to stop their idea. Rather, they should try and think how to make these ideas into a real prototype. Then they will be successful. Next, we have Sriram Jasaswit from 11A. He has chosen the topic health and thought of designing a portal where he can use for selling of used medicines. The medicines which we are getting, if we are getting it in a file, but if it is left out, then we are simply throwing it. So he has thought of that, let's use those used medicines. A very nice idea, indeed, Sridham. But these ideas should end up with an actual prototype. That will be a real success. Okay. I request all the students to come up to the dais. Amrapali Madam, Param Guru Sir, please come up to the stage so that we can have a group photograph. Now I would request all the dais dignitaries to take their seat. Now I would request Mr. Subhadipta Jena to propose the vote of thanks. Sir, please.
A very good afternoon to this August assembly on this virtual platform. As we have come to the end of this special observation of fourth foundation day of Atal Tinkering Laboratory, let me take the privilege of proposing the formal vote of thanks. On behalf of Team DAV Chandrasekharpur, I express my deepest sense of gratitude to our esteemed research person, Mr. Dhruv Saidava, founder Tinker India Foundation, for accepting our invitation to share his rich experiences in the field of artificial intelligence. Sir, thank you very much for sharing your valuable time despite your hectic visit to me. We are highly grateful to you, sir, for your inspiring words, innovative ideas, practical skills, and rich knowledge in the field of artificial intelligence that you have shared with us today. I am confident the young innovators, entrepreneurs, teachers, students will be benefited to a great extent from this webinar. I also deem it a unique privilege to convey our heartfelt thanks to Master Tej Patel, the young, dynamic, and vibrant entrepreneur, to be part of this program and presenting the practical skill on origami. Dear young innovator, I am specially thankful to you for sharing your expertise, your craftsmanship in the field of origami. I am sure our student community must have gained a lot of knowledge and skills out of this. My sincere and heartfelt gratitude to our revered principal, come regional officer, DAV Institutions, Odisha Joint One, Dr. Keshav Chandra Satpathy sir, for being our team leader and pathfinder in this learning expedition. I am immensely thankful to all the respected principals, teachers, student delegates from our sister concerned organizations for being a part of this special occasion. A special bouquet of thanks to our coordinator, ma'am, who is also the convener of Atal Tinkering Laboratory, for our kind help, valuable suggestions, constant support, thoughtful guidance to make this event a memorable occasion. I also express my heartfelt reverence to all the supervisors, Madam Niharika Gandhar, Pramod Kumar Patra sir, Anjushri Prasad madam, Nihar Jana sir, for making this event a very successful one. On this special day, let me not forget to appreciate the effort of my own colleagues, particularly Mr. J.R. Mohanty, Mr. S.K. Paramguru, Madam Amrapalli Panda, the teacher mentors of Atal Tinkering Laboratory, towards making this occasion a very successful one despite this pandemic. I am immensely thankful to all my teacher colleagues and our young student innovators for being a part of this webinar. I hope you must have enriched through this small endeavor of ours. My special congratulations to all the winners of Ideas into Designing competition organized as part of AGL Kickstart 2021. I convey my sincere thanks to all of you students as well as your parents for being present to receive your prize and certificate. Once again, congratulations to you. I think I shall be failing in my duty if I do not convey our sincere thanks to Mr. Dipti Ranjan and Mr. Nihar for their overall technical support for smooth conduct of the program. I am specially thankful to Madam Isai Sita Satpathy for her kind cooperation, valuable suggestions to make this program a remarkable one. Last but not least, let me convey our sincere thanks to each and everyone associated with this event directly or indirectly and have helped us to make this program a grand success. Let the Almighty keep showering His love and blessing upon all of us. Let keep thinking, learning, and declaring. With this, I thank you all, and we also come to the end of